All right, guys, so welcome to this week's lab. This week we're looking at hydrology and more or less groundwater infiltration and soil porosity, things like that, as well as a few streams. So let's get started. So first off, this is just kind of an overview of the hydrologic cycle. We're not going to be looking at all these aspects. We're mainly going to be looking at number six here and number seven. So we're going to be looking at groundwater infiltration and a little bit of groundwater flow or subsurface flow. But more or less, we're going to be looking at here how groundwater infiltrates the surface and how water moves pretty much beneath the surface, more or less. And again, this kind of shows where which one goes if you guys want to do the PowerPoint. So yeah, first one's evaporation, second is transportation, you have condensation, and then you have precipitation here, then you have runoff, and then you'll have infiltration, which is again what we'll be looking at, number six, and then subsurface flow. Again, but this is a good little kind of animation on how the hydrologic cycle works. And then this is a real world example, or just kind of real life images labeled with the water cycle. Again, we're going to be looking at infiltration, soil moisture in a way, and then groundwater flow. So let's talk about how groundwater occurs. Let's talk about how it permeates the soil or the ground. And so how that happens is through soil porosity. And so what soil porosity is, simply put, is it's just the space between soil particles. And so how you see it here is there's three different, well, there's more than three different types, but for this lab, we'll just look at three different types of soil porosities. So from left to right, we'll look at the leftmost image. The leftmost image here is you have no space. You have barely any space between these soil particles. So that means there's no space for water to flow. It's not very porous. It's not porous at all. It's not very permeable. It has very low permeability. So not a lot of water can flow through that. Not any water can flow through that. So that is a very low permeable soil, if you will. Now, if we look at the rightmost image, you have a very porous, very permeable pore space. So the space between these soil particles is much larger. It's very porous. It's very permeable. It has high permeability for groundwater, for water to flow through and create groundwater. You have a lot of groundwater infiltration can occur here. So that's how soil porosity works. And how this, as this third bullet point puts, low porosity means less pore space, and that retains more water. So if you have low porosity, like if you look at the leftmost image here, then you can form maybe lakes or ponds can form above that type of soil. Since if it rains a lot, but you have very small space between the soil particles, you can get lakes or ponds above that soil, because it's not permeating the ground. It's not going through that soil space because there is no space. As opposed to the far right, you have a ton of space between the soil particles. You can get a lot of groundwater from that. A lot of water can infiltrate that soil, go underground, and you can pretty much get a large groundwater storage from that type of soil space. So that's how soil porosity works. Now, next up is streams. You're gonna be looking at two different types of streams for this lab. And so the first one is braided streams. And you can think of these as almost like hair. I don't know if you've ever braided hair, but you take kind of multiple handfuls of hair, if you will, and you kind of cross them together. It's usually three, right? And you have kind of these three handfuls of hair that you kind of cross and twist and whatever. And that's the same with streams. You have multiple channels of water. They're usually shallow because you have a lot of them. and they kind of combine, they cross, and they form, and that's how you get braided streams. As you see in this image, this bottom left part of the slide, this is a good image of how, this is how you get braided streams. You just, you have a bunch of water flows, and it usually results in islands. Again, they're very shallow. They're usually pretty shallow braided streams, and you just have multiple of them. And so that's what braided streams look like. Now, the opposite of that, if you will, are meandering streams. And meandering streams, it's just a single stream of water, and it's usually snake-like, as you can see here. Water moves faster in these because it's a single stream. It's very, very curvy. It's, again, like a snake. And you start to get, you get these parts of the stream. We'll start with the cut bank, for example. So since water moves faster in meandering streams, it hits these curves at a faster rate. And since the water is moving faster, it's kind of eroding at these curves here. It's called a cut bank. So these eroded curves are called cut banks because the water is almost crashing into them and kind of wearing away at these edges. And that's where the faster water is too. And so that it's an erosional surface because water is hitting it at such a faster rate. Now, on the opposite of that, on the inside of these curves, you have point bars. And what's happening here is deposition. So let's take, instead of eroding at like at the, what they do at cut banks, they're depositing soil and different other particles, like rock particles, because that's where the slower water is. So water is moving faster on the outer edge, eroding that outer curve, but yet on the inside, you're getting deposition. It's leaving, if you will, soil particles, rock particles, kind of building up this, what's called a point bar. And that's on the inside of these curves. And what you get with these is, we'll go to the next slide for this, are something called oxbow lakes. Now, how these oxbow lakes form, what you see at the bottom here, is you have water coming in. It's kind of forming this like horseshoe-like feature, if you will. The red parts of these images are where erosion is occurring because water is just, it's coming in at a higher speed. It's kind of wearing away at where this, these red parts are. And eventually it's going to wear away at the, this neck, it's what it's labeled as. And it's going to kind of pretty much erode it away completely. And you'll have a stream that kind of flows straight through. And what it leaves is eventually water stops flowing through to these horseshoe-shaped parts of the lake. And it eventually forms an oxbow lake. The reason it's a lake, obviously, because there's no water flowing in or out. So eventually you start with, again, horseshoe-like structure, water's flowing through it. Again, it's just, you have, since water is flowing through at a certain rate, obviously fast enough for erosion, it's going to erode away that curve in general. It's just going to flow straight through. And once it flows straight through, stops flowing through the horseshoe part of the lake, you get an oxbow lake. And that's what you see at the bottom part of the slide is an oxbow lake. I think it looks more like a horseshoe, but so it's like an oxbow. It's called an oxbow lake. And that's, again, that's formed from meandering streams. It's pretty much water flowing through fast enough to erode away the part that's making a curve and pretty much just cutting off the water flow to the horseshoe-like structure, forming an oxbow lake. And so the last slide is just to kind of show you the contrast between braided streams and meandering streams. Again, it's very different. Braided streams, you have multiple, you have a bunch, usually smaller, usually shallow, whereas meandering stream is just one snake-like stream. And so that's the last slide of this PowerPoint. And now just to go over a few things for the lab, the main takeaway for this video is you're gonna get three different soil types. Now the times don't need to be exact. You're gonna record times when water flows through it. They don't need to be exact, but you need to be able to see a change. So you're going to look at three different soil types, or three different samples, if you will. Sample A, sample B, and sample C. Now, each one, you should get a different time for each sample, and then a different water amount for each sample. Now, the times that need to be exact, Dr. Workman Ford, she pretty much explains the, she tells you how much, so you should get relatively accurate amount of water. But the times that need to be exact, you just need to be able to see a difference. And so when you see that difference, it'll help you answer the last few questions, questions 7 through 11 on, you know, the soil types. And then the next part, you're looking at a type of stream. Again, that should be answered by the PowerPoint. Again, once you know the types of streams, you should be able to answer the other questions. Again, just refer back to the PowerPoint. That should really help you. And now the next part, you're going to be looking at groundwater maps. And so I recommend downloading the PDF. So clicking this arrow, and it should give you a PDF here. Click the PDF. That way you have all the maps right here, and you can scroll through them, zoom in or out, or whatever, so you can see them better. Now, what you guys are looking at here, more or less, are topographic maps. We're not going to go into the deep details of them. I'll just give you a quick rundown. What you're looking at here are elevations. So these numbers right here in on these lines are showing elevations. So what that means is this 140 here, this 140 is 140 feet. So every point along this line, since it's labeled 140, every point along this line has an elevation of 140 feet. Now, if we go up here to 160 feet right here, that means every point along this line is 160 feet. And we'll keep going up again, 180 feet, same thing. The line that's labeled 180, every point along this line is 180 feet. And so that's what you're looking at here is our contours. These are contours, contour lines. So if you go down in elevation from 140 to, or 180 to 140 feet, you're going down in elevation. Or if you start at 140, go up to 180, you're going at 180 feet. You're going up in elevation. And so what you guys are looking at is groundwater elevation. And that's where this star is. So this green star is gonna be more or less in the center of the map. On every map you're looking at, you're looking at different years, and you're gonna try to look at the elevation of this star on every map. So in this case, this one is kind of looking at the elevation. It's between 180 feet and 200 feet. And it's right in the middle of that. So how you discern the difference? Well, what's in between 180 and 200? Yeah, and that's going to be your answer for this. So you're going to do this for every year. Most years, the star will be directly on a line that is labeled, but in this case, it's kind of in between. So it's going to be more arbitrary. And so the point of this is you should see a pattern. You're going to start at 1 year, and you're going to start at 1958, and you're going to end on 2010, I believe. 2005. Yes, 2010. And so what you're going to do is you're going to look at a pattern in groundwater over time. And once you see that pattern, you should be able to answer the following questions. So that pattern over time will help you answer these questions. And again, you're just looking at the elevation that this green star is on, that this groundwater is on. And so that should help you answer the questions. And then the last part of the lab is going to be another, it's going to take you to a different website. It's going to be a little more interactive. And that one should be kind of straightforward. Let me know if the link doesn't work, or if you have any questions, or if you have any problems with the link. But yeah, so that one's going to be kind of a separate external link right here. Should click that, should take you to here, and that should load for you. If it doesn't load, just let me know. So yeah, so that's more or less going to be the lab. Again, make sure to refer back to the PowerPoint to help you with that beginning part. And yeah, again, let me know if you have any questions, any problems, any concerns. Again, if you have a question, it's more it's likely that other people have that question and they're just either too afraid to ask as well, or too nervous, or maybe they think someone else asked it, who knows. But so just, again, if you have a question, don't be afraid to ask. And yeah, hope you guys have a great week. And again, let me know. Thanks.